All right, here we go. All right, guys, my name is Alan Oldham, a.k.a. DJT1000. And we're here for a nice discussion here at HÖR. And I'm accompanied by...
We'll try to keep it nice. We'll try to keep
it nice. Of course. I'm here with accompanied by Lenny Posso from Thema Recordings. He's the head honcho, the A&R, the man. Over 100 releases on that label. Many of the big name techno artists that you're familiar with have recorded for Thema Records. And this is Waynette, the lovely Waynette.
Hi.
And she is a Berliner DJ. And I asked her here for her unique perspective as a black German female techno DJ. So, I was kind of asked to put this together to talk about.
Thank you. Thank you for having us.
Well, yeah.
Thank you very much.
Yeah. And, And I was asked to put this together, and we were, I guess the topic is, you know, diversity in the scene, the challenges of DJs of color in the scene as it is now. I guess ultimately where we go from here in the age of COVID-19, because nobody's really DJing right now, no clubs or whatever. So is this possibly a reset moment for what we know? We could talk a little bit about these kind of illegal raves as well. I mean, I had a few questions.
Did you just say illegal graves or raves? Was that pun intended?
Hey, now, wait.
Hey, exactly, right?
That's a little morbid, but I mean,
some would think and argue that that is what we do, or that's what's going to happen, and that's a bit dark because I think we've been in a lot of situations where we're all forced in a group, and you know, I was just on a plane, and I felt more claustrophobic, or too close to people on a plane than I did in an illegal grave I was just at 2 weeks ago.
Yeah, see, and you know, so we can talk about that a little bit later because you know, I had I had some, you know, kind of questions that I've been thinking about, you know, but we can talk about that later.
Sure.
But right now, let's dive right in. Whitewashing of techno. I mean, as we know that, you know, techno has black roots. You know, well, it's kind of known to have Detroit roots, and then you have Chicago techno DJs like Mike Dearborn, DJ Rush, you know. But strangely enough, a lot of these black DJs, DJs of color, are not getting booked at these big events. So what is your opinion of that? What is your take on that? Lenny?
Do you really want me to start?
Did you hear that question? You know, that's what we're here for.
Yeah. True. So let me let it all out. No. I don't know. I'm just starting to really kind of, I think we've all noticed and we can all sort of say the big culprit of what has propelled artists to hit a point of playing often has a lot to do with their social media hype game.
Right.
You know, now there's totally different levels of this where it's very commercial and obviously they have the whole A&R team and the label and all that pushing that stuff. We could talk about that. We could also talk about just people paying individually to get their name up there.
The B word, business techno.
Business techno. And then we have those, you know, grassroots version of just plugging away at, you know, social media. But I feel that nowadays it has a lot to do with social media being the biggest component or catapult to bring people to be booked to play. It doesn't seem any longer that it has anything to do with skill. Mm-hmm. Not to say a lot of these people aren't skilled, but I think we can all agree to how it seems. It doesn't really matter about skill, you know. And when I say skill, like, can you match beats? Can you not just depend on, you know, the technology to make you sound good? You know, that takes a veteran, that takes a skill or an ear, someone that's been doing it for a long time. Depending on situations, opening sets, house parties, a change of your own, maybe even like your comfort zone. Because a lot of times you thrown in a DJ, oh wait, I had a set prepared, but this is not gonna work. You know, how do I boom jump into that? What's your take? What do you think? I mean,
I have the same opinion, and it's who you can sell the best, and I think it's a bit sad because you have many artists who are really, who have the skill, and they're maybe not into showing themselves that much, and they just get lost somewhere.
Yeah. I mean, it's tricky. It's tricky because, I understand the social media game, but I think that a lot of places lose the responsibility that's given to them to also help those other artists come up to play. Some that I might even mention.
No.
Advertising.
we got to keep it nice. Got to keep it nice. The opinions of Lenny Posso in no way reflects the opinion of.
Hey, you brought me on here, man.
Yeah. I feel though. Just from a black perspective, a lot of my contemporaries or younger, people who came up in the 90s, a lot of guys are not hip to the game as it's played now. You know, a lot of guys, I know cats who are, you know, I was the shit in the 90s, you know. Back in 99, I was the man, you know, but now it's...
Rightfully so.
You got the legacy, but now you have to play the game as it's played today. And a lot of cats have not made the jump into basically 21st century game in terms of social media and hustle, you know, the way it is now. It's some guys that are definitely out of touch. You know, that I won't name.
Sure.
But and a lot of that kind of holds us back as black artists. You know, I know one artist. He's not black, but he's of color, and his whole idea was people come to me. You know, like they want to book me, they want my tracks, they have to come to me. But you know, you have to sell yourself all the time. You know, and it's not even really about what you
do. Do we?
Well, not now.
Do we?
Not now, because
the point I think of some of these big social media or big organizations that are out there, I think it should be up to them. And let's also go back to the question, like resetting COVID. I think this is a good starting point.
It's definitely a
recognize these other artists, you know, legends, done many records that we're still playing today. Or many times, like half of these big DJs, they go up there and they're playing those classic tracks. Yeah, what is that?
But what I'm saying 99. Is, but a lot of, but you know, what I'm saying is, there's a lot of cats that are not, they're not in it the way it is today. That's all I'm saying.
Granted.
You know, so, but will COVID be a reset? We'll see. I mean, we're seeing these business techno guys out playing shows like right now, even in the middle of COVID, you know, so, I mean, I have no idea. You know,
it'd be interesting to see how it plays out because we don't have the forum anymore. We don't have the clubs really per se. Some clubs opened in Berlin over the weekend and stuff, but no dancing. I haven't heard anything actually about Bergheim with the outdoor area.
No,
I haven't heard anything. But I know they opened, and I'm sure it was packed, and I'm sure people were waiting in 12-hour line. But how did it play out? Am I going to run to a club right now? I don't think so.
Yeah.
You know, I want a little time, but I know a lot of people feel that way. But it'd be interesting to see how that plays out.
Definitely. Yeah. So one last thing before we get into music. We were talking before about, you know, the whitewashing thing. And there's a kind of a subtopic called Detroit washing.
Wait, let's get into that after some tracks, right?
Could be a long one.
Oh, no. Well,
okay, well, just give us a quick thought on that, and then we can get to the music.
I think that it needs to be presented with the full, what does that mean?
Full context.
Yeah, that's what I said, maybe.
You know, you're blowing my segue. You have to stick to the script. All right. Music from Lenny Posso. We're going to take a quick musical break. Music from Lenny Posso, and he is showcasing theme tracks.
No, actually, I'm going to play a mixed bag.
See, this guy's blowing my whole thing. No. He told you. You told me that you're going to play all FEMA, and now you're not playing all FEMA.
No, I have enough tracks.
Stick to the script. Lenny Posso, ladies and gentlemen. We'll be right back.
Cheers. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Oh, yeah.
The headphones.
Yeah, we're kind of messing around here, man.
Oh, that now it's not playing at all, the
okay,
sound
cool.
of the record.
All right.
It's just back to conversation.
Back to the conversation. Okay, dig this. So, all right. I had the mic off.
Oh.
This is a fucking disaster.
It's the first time. Figure it out.
Anyway, Lenny Posso, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you. Cheers.
Playing a quick...
Berlin, Brooklyn.
Playing a quick set. Thank you for that. So, okay, this thing in the U.S. that we were talking about Detroit, blah, blah, blah. What I call it Detroit washing, where Detroit gets all the props for creating techno, and it leaves out many other people and places, you know, like New York or whatever. You were talking about that the other day. So explain, expand, put in context.
No, I mean, I find it an interesting point of view. I think a lot of people, you know, I'm living here now for a while. It's interesting to say, like, coming from New York, we had a different vision of Europe, and we know that it has a strong culture here, and it's been going on for a lot longer than, say, the States, or let's say it's the same time. But as far as, I think it's, yeah,
go ahead.
Moving here gave me definitely a full-on perspective. Well, we see how it's working under the hood,
mm-hmm.
and where in some organizations or the topics, the people, the questions. And a lot of people tend to think that a lot of music just come when we talk about the States, when we say USA, we think only Detroit. Really,
right.
It's like this.
Also Chicago.
Oh, Chicago, yeah.
Right.
New York, Miami, L.A., you know, Atlanta, even the Midwest, Minneapolis, Grand Rapids, Austin, Texas. There's a long list of cities where they have also a rich culture and labels and artists that they get played or paid. played also by big artists and stuff like that. And a lot of times it just seems that Detroit is the one that they only, or Chicago, the two that really they get spoken about or
exactly.
recognized, per
right,
se.
Right.
You know, for us New Yorkers, LA, who have also a very rich history in the music, this is a topic because we also recognize that, hey, what about us? You know? And it's a slippery slope, you
yeah.
know, because, you know, let's also bring up race, everything that we're being sensitive about now is finally coming to the table.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it should. I think we should discuss these things and figure it out, or just to sort of give it a tone.
Mm-hmm.
Because, you know, some of these things are obvious. They are on the table. We do talk about it. And being a long-time person in the scene, in the music, you said 100 releases. That's 100 releases, all three labels, though, not just Thema.
Right.
The other two are Chronicle and Thema Digital, just for those that don't know. I find it interesting. We find it interesting, you know. There's a lot of things coming out of New York now, as of recently, let me say.
Yeah.
I mean, we have a long history, you know. We all know the favorites, Sine Wave, Sonic Groove, you know, Frankie Bones, all these things have precedence. They made their Lenny D.
Joey Beltram.
Steve Stoll. Yeah. Damon Wild. Function. You know, but these are old names. These are old names, too. All important, but now there's a new breed. There's a whole new thing coming out of New York, which I'm proud of. I'm happy to see it, and I'm part of that with Thema. The main reason I started the label was because I felt that New York didn't have enough presence in the scene. Did I get the love from New York? That's a different question.
That's a different story.
That's all. Tune in next time. No, but what's your take or thinking or opinion of the whitewashing? The Detroit washing.
I was still in Detroit washing. Like, I wasn't that aware about it. It's the first time I heard this word.
Well, no,
and I was just...
Yeah.
I
kind of just made that word up like a day yesterday.
It's interesting because, I think, there are many other cities, as you said, where people were also making up the scene. And
we're players.
There's a question like why this happened, or why is it like only those two cities you know about or think about if you hear if you think about black techno or black music history,
just electronic music per se.
It just seems like to me that back 30 years ago, Detroit techno is what got the press, like 30 years ago, almost 35 years ago. This whole thing was kind of, this whole name Detroit techno was coined and it was pushed heavily, and the original three guys were pushed heavily, and you know, when you're first in the market, I mean, that's kind of the marketing rule. You're first in the market and you set that tone, right? To where other copy machines are called Xerox, even though they're not Xerox machines. Like it becomes a generic term. And a lot of guys who come later or whatever don't get the same props, unfortunately. And, you know, a lot of guys don't hustle for props either, but that's another story. That's another story, because you got to hustle for props. Doesn't just drop in your lap, you know. But people don't want to hear that, so I want to have a career when I get off here. So, but, yeah, you know, so I think that's the reason why Detroit was kind of held up as the front runner. I think that the weird thing about Chicago is that Chicago is a house city, house town. All house.
Yeah, and they take also New York as a house town, right? Too. Yeah, because of, okay, fair enough. Also, the gay scene or the club scene in the beginning was very house-oriented.
Absolutely, but then you've got these, in Chicago, you had that weird offshoot of, like not just techno, but banging techno.
Hard house. Let's
like, super hard.
Hard house,
And then that's where you get the DJ Rush, DJ Skull, Dearborn, et cetera. A lot of those guys that were on Djax-Up-Beats back in the day. Many of whom don't make tracks anymore.
Who
or whatever.
Was designed and created the artwork by?
Well, you know.
Advertising again.
Yeah, you know.
Plug it in.
That's irrelevant.
DJOldham.com.
That's irrelevant to the conversation. I mean, I did the artwork for Djax, you know.
For many years.
You know, that's irrelevant to the conversation. But yeah, so that's kind of why I think that people kind of always focus on Detroit, and then a lot of newer artists now sound like Detroit. Back in the day, it's now it's become a sound.
This is what I thought about Detroit washing at the beginning, and I also think we're talking about Detroit washing, and it was pushed, but maybe not pushed enough, because we are at the whitewashing point now.
Yeah.
So.
Well, the scene hangs on to the top guys.
Okay.
I think, you know, like the scene hangs on to the top guys. Derek May, Carl Craig, Jeff Mills. Those are like the names, Rob Hood. I mean, these are the big names you see, festivals, clubs, you know, whatever. And the house guys are really big, though. That's
The house guys are huge. Norm Talley.
They're huge.
Kyle
Delano
Hall,
Smith.
Delano Smith.
Marcellus Pittman.
Yeah, man. Oh, yeah. Theo, I mean.
You can't get a bit moody, man.
No.
You can't get no bigger than him.
Oh, my God. God forbid we forget a name right now.
Well, we love everybody, but we're under pressure.
We're under pressure
here, so we might not remember every name. But yeah, it's a lot of big cats. So it's wild, man. I mean,
the bar is high. The bar is high. Let's say that. Yeah,
totally.
But there are other places that are making significant waves, and you know, now I'm happy to see more New York sections or even LA sections in a lot more bins and record shops globally.
Yeah. I remember there was nothing out of LA.
Remember
back, you're a veteran. You remember back in the day it was nothing but like really cheesy rave stuff coming out of LA?
Oh, yeah, for years. Like all that stuff. I don't want to diss LA though.
I'm not, but see, no, I'm setting the basis. Yeah. You know, I'm talking about the cheesy rave stuff from the 90s so I can get to the truncate and drum cell today.
Developer.
Oh, yeah. We can't forget about Adrian.
Adrian. Good
yeah.
Adrian.
He beat us up if we forgot about him.
Silent Servant. No, but there's a lot of crews coming out of L.A. and really kind of embraced, they have definitely embraced the techno sound.
You know, what's weird, before COVID-19, L.A. was killing it for shows.
Yeah, I was... trying to get out there, hint and play out there.
I was there in 2018, and you know, I was just checking out, talking to some people, and they had like a lot of names coming through there, man. A lot of shows.
Yes.
And it's a shame because the virus shut it down.
Props.
And I was like you. I was gonna go out there on my own steam. So no gigs. Just go to live in LA for like a week.
I've never been. I've only been to San Fran.
What? Are you serious? Sorry. You never been to LA?
I've never been to LA.
Oh, brother, you gotta go. Well, now I mean, obviously nobody's going anywhere.
Wait, I'm gonna do the stairs.
That was good. No, when this thing clears up, man, you got to go to LA.
Yeah, I do.
I love it out there. That was my original plan, was to go out there, like way back in the day when I left Detroit. The plan was to move west like the covered wagons back in the day. So I was going to Detroit, Chicago for a couple of years, save my money, and make the jump to LA. But LA didn't happen. And
oh, no, you good call. Berlin is a great city.
Oh, man, it's great.
It's a great city.
It's just the way it worked out.
A lot of love here. A lot of love also from, you know, expats who put their time and play here. It's not easy. Don't get me wrong. Everybody thinks this is all like a free meal ticket or something. It's hard. We got to work our, you know,
make it work. It's a nonstop hustle.
It's a nonstop.
Totally is.
It's not one thing, it's another. This week I have to finish up my visa.
Oh, man.
Good luck.
Good luck with that. Seriously, we want you here next year.
Yeah. Oh, I'll be here. I'm not going back to Trump.
We were talking about that. So one last thing that I wanted to bring up from my own perspective, and then we'll let Waynette play. Just an observation from my own perspective about, you know, being a black techno DJ. For me, is that a lot of people don't want. There's only like a couple of us that play techno. Like real techno. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And it's like just two or three in my kind of echelon, I think. Like Rolando, DJ Bone, me. Rob is kind of.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, but, yeah. You know.
Rightfully so.
Exactly. Right? Yeah. But, you know, it's funny because, you know, if you play anything over 126, they don't want to book you if you're black. They want you to play house. You know, I used to play like 135 or something, they'd be like looking at me like funny. Like, why do you play so hard? You know, it's just crazy. And I often said that if me and Ben Sims played the exact same set in the exact same order, he would get props and I wouldn't. Because he's Ben Sims and he's killing it like 140. Mm. But see, me, I'm supposed to be playing house. I'm supposed to be funky and low tempo. And
who are these people thinking that you're supposed to be playing that? Let me talk to them.
I mean, that's something that I've discovered. You know, it's getting better now, though. Mm. I mean, but there was a time, about 6 years ago where it was pretty rife, where people would just look at you funny. And you'd be playing like old Underground Resistance records at their normal BPM, like Punisher. Punisher was like 140, like when they first came out.
Ooh.
And, you know, you're playing stuff at the original BPM, and they still don't want you to play that hard. You're supposed to be playing – I'm supposed to play like Derek Carter, you know. So that's, you know, now – I've never really said anything about this, but now this is kind of the time we can talk about all this kind of stuff.
This is when we all let it out.
That's right.
Tune in next time.
Because we don't, you know, don't have to worry about careers anymore because nobody's getting booked.
So, Alan, you're fired.
I know, right? You're fired. So anyway, enough of that. And we're gonna let Waynette load up her tracks.
Loading.
And I'm gonna vamp a little bit and talk shit while she gets it. You know, she could have also put it in that one also.
Is it?
Oh, it doesn't matter.
Yeah.
Am I allowed to use your headphones?
Of course.
Yes, Waynette is a younger name. She's been playing for a few years here in Berlin and around. And, she has a very, very unique perspective that we wanted to bring into the discussion.
Still searching?
And she's still searching? That's all right. We got time.
Shall we just continue?
Yeah.
Let's just talk shit.
That's what we do best.
So yeah, we're finally getting some hot weather over here in Berlin. So some
you see me sweating on camera here.
It's hot in here today, and we were just at the lake. The other day?
Was it yesterday? Day before.
Yeah.
We were out at the lake.
Thank God, because it almost seemed like summer was going to pass us by this year.
I mean, it didn't get warm until August.
Until last week.
Last week, it rained all through July.
And cold weather.
Right, and we would have a hot day, but you couldn't plan to go anywhere because by the middle of the day, it would be cloudy and cold again. You know,
some can hang with that.
Not me.
I like the warm weather.
That's what we sacrifice being here in Berlin is consistent weather.
Last year though, it was great. Last year we had a summer. It was hot.
Right.
I got a tan. I was actually tanned.
Wow. Good man.
You know.
So how are we doing? All right. Check. All right. Good. All right, ladies and gentlemen, this is Waynette. That was Waynette, kind of a representative thing of what she sounds like. Woo!
Thank you.
Yeah. So where were we when we left off? We left off at the BPM. Yeah, and
my
what's
my favorite topic?
And what's what's expected of certain DJs?
Yes.
Yeah. It seems like it all has to make sense.
Definitely.
You know what I mean?
Definitely. The room, the space, the time. The location,
yeah.
You know.
So, have you guys? Oh no, go ahead. Have you guys had any particular challenges with your careers in terms of getting booked? Like, I, obviously, whenever I talk about something like that, it's before COVID-19. Like, you know, the status quo,
sure.
as it was.
I mean, now it's non-existent.
Well, now it's non-existent.
Yeah.
You know, that, which is good because it allows all this to be discussed.
I'm enjoying it, to be honest. I mean, it sucks for some who are solely dependent on it, but I think it was good to stand back a little bit. There were many Saturdays where I got confused with a Tuesday. Because
yeah.
I was like, I'm just going home, and there was no bars or anything open. So that was, I'm sure many of us had that same experience. Like, wait a minute, is it Tuesday or is it Saturday?
Mm-hmm. But before this, in terms of you getting booked, doing shows, did you face any particular challenges other than the normal DJ hustling for gigs type thing?
No, I can't
really
say I personally have experienced.
Really.
I mean, that's I had to think deeply. I'm sure I have a story to fit in there, but I can't think of anything at the moment. I mean, we're all it's a hustle to get the gigs.
Yeah.
You mean the challenge of getting booked, right?
Yeah.
Maybe.
Well, for you as you're a younger DJ, you just starting, so.
Maybe the locations. Like, I've been told not to play at special locations.
Really?
Just because of, like,
No names given?
Yeah, if you play there, you will have a bad DJ meter. You will have problems or struggles.
Really?
But to be honest, I didn't care. Because I...
Well, good for you, because I did the same thing. I lost gigs because I started playing at this club and that club, and that's a given... I think that's inner city politics. You know, there's this vision that these DJs we all know which ones too want exclusivity. That's an interesting point to bring up, because that is the truth. I also was playing at places that I knew that they didn't, not that they didn't verbally say it, but you heard like, hey, no, if you play there, you're not going to.
But I think you can be a DJ and think about it, but you can also be the DJ who's more into the people who want to listen to you. Like, you give the dancers or the clubbers, you give them a gift. And I think this is the most important thing, to focus on the crowd and not on what's happening around, because it's the moment, the night you give something.
I would also put in that topic or that tone too, a lot of times when you hear this thing where, but it's all tourists. You know what? With that being said, it's a full room, say on a given Tuesday night, and they're all screaming.
Tourists are the best crowds.
Let's just
Because
very thankful.
As it was explained to me by Ellen Alien, who is an expert on this whole business, Ellen is basically like, if you play somewhere where it's a lot of tourists, then those people go back to where they're from, and then they'll talk about you there, and then maybe you'll get booked in that place because they were in Berlin. Oh, I was in Berlin. I saw this DJ. He or she was great.
Sure,
and, you know, this person may live in Spain or Portugal or maybe from somewhere else, and then
they
might
spread
talk,
the word.
Right,
it's
and they talk
important.
To... Exactly.
Sometimes I'd say I'd almost prefer a room full of tourists than a room full of bitter...
jaded
Berliner.
Oh, I've seen this all before. This is so boring.
Yeah.
You know, and hold the cigarette like this. Yeah.
Yeah.
It's sehr schlecht.
You know,
So, yeah, you know. You know what was a really good club that I used to really like to play? But I would only play 125 and below at this club, Chalet.
Chalet was awesome, man.
Chalet.
That room was fun.
It was
a
super
fun
good.
Room. And given night, I mean, some nights were a bit not on point. But Chalet was a lot of fun playing, I would say.
I never played
and
over 126 at this place.
Also is Renata.
Renata?
Yeah.
I played there once.
Yeah, I like the downstairs first floor. I think Sabine is taking over that room a lot recently. Mm.
Sabina Hoffman.
Hi.
Shouts. No, it's a
beautiful
fun room.
Sabina.
It's a fun room to play. Yeah. But I would also, Sisyphus too. Hammerhall is really a
Hammerhall.
Hammerhall.
And the sad really nice place that we, you know, Grießmühlen. Rest in peace. Yeah. Hopefully they work it out.
There is a new Grießmühlen.
Yeah, I figured
but nobody can play there now.
Yeah.
Well, you know, let's see who's standing too after all this. There's talk Tresor is having trouble. I mean, that's what I'm
all
saying. Like, this is let's talk about that. You know, they could shove us into a plane full of people, but we can't stand in a dance room with others. And, you know, here we are and 10,000 people protests, and you know the clubs are closed.
It's
valid point for all of it, for our health. Yes, don't get me wrong. I don't want to take away that we need to be careful. You know, COVID. We don't know what this is going to do. How hard it's going.
You know what? It does. It does seem to be a selective thing.
Yes.
Right. You can have.
That's what I'm getting at.
20,000 people for George Floyd. Protest in Berlin. I mean, that was a very important thing, to be sure.
Yes, it was. Yes, it was.
20,000 people. That's not a super spreader event. That's okay.
But then there's other.
I think
we need to take precaution in the dance music thing, of course. But like, we should talk about that. We should really investigate these options. How we can continue our
exactly.
Culture. We all need it. We all want it. We're doing it illegally. I've seen already some things, and people are continue, you know, going and taking it in their own hands.
Yeah.
Granted, but it's something that we're always going to do. It will always.
Right.
We need that. It is.
But see,
know.
those kind of events get a lot of bad pushback on social media.
Yes, they are.
They're accused of being super spreaders.
You know, and that's we need to chill with that, because there's a lot of things that I've been to where it's like, whoa, wait a minute, these guys are not even wearing masks and.
It just
on
seems
top
like
of each other.
It seems like for me personally, it just seems like a selective. It's a selective thing.
Let's be honest, because all the clubs are closed at the
moment. Well, we're not talking about just clubs. I'm just talking about in terms of gatherings here in Berlin. Period.
Yeah.
It just seems like
what's okay and what's
if
not
it's,
okay.
Yeah, if it's some sort of thing that's hipster approved, it's all right.
But
you know.
Sorry for interrupting.
No, please.
Maybe we were talking about COVID is like it's like a reboot, like it's starting off again.
Yeah. Much
and
needed.
And maybe this is we don't have enough like parties or a few illegal parties, and maybe this is the point of reboot, because smaller or underground people are able to play, and the guests. They're like so happy, or so they really.
Yeah, I've played at a couple places, and they're so extremely happy to be a part or there, or whatever. But
so this makes the chance for like the smaller DJs to like
have
a name.
Well, let's also bring that up too. I think this is the reboot. I think that we need to also start focusing a little bit more on, say, booking the local artists.
Yeah.
A little bit more, because bringing to conversation full circle now from what we were saying about before. And who's getting booked, who's not getting booked. I mean, we bring up these topics because these are the topics that are involved in our, you know, present moment during COVID, us as artists, us as people who are involved, you know. We're witnessing a lot of different changes and transitions, and I think it's interesting to point to bring these topics up these days to discuss it, understand it, and also to leave it in other people's minds that these are valid points to bring up during this time. COVID has been crazy. There's a lot of things at play here, a lot of transitions, a lot of, you know, I'm very concerned about the clubs, that when this does clear up, that we might not have clubs to return to. That's a hard thing. How is that going to be managed? Is the government going to step in, or is it going to be left to us to save these clubs?
I think it's important that they give more help, because this is what built up the city also, which makes the city important. Mm-hmm. So,
I mean, the city generates a lot of money and you know, income in all different ways, from housing to even restaurants and bars and hotels and transportation and record shops, because a lot of times I'm in a record shop, it's a lot of tourists coming in and buying these records, and I have friends when they come in New York that they just go record shopping the whole time, and it's valid, it's important to do that and to sustain the culture and also the generation of, or generating of money and revenue for the city. And yeah, I think that we do need this to happen, where the government either helps us or allows us to go back to business to help save this, you know. I mean, people are going to illegal raves. Why? Because they're dying, not dying physically, I mean, we all know, you know, are anxious and need a release. Of course, let's all be safe, let's all even discuss other options of what we can do to be able to be back in a club environment, or a appreciation of music thing. And you know, do we need to stay 3 feet away? Yeah, let's stay farther from our groups or our friends or our dates. But let us continue to do this for people, and let us bring the music that we, you know, we love and that we've built up for so long. And how can we do that? What do we got to do? You know?
We'll see. Yeah. You know, I mean, we're in this situation now where we just have to wait and see what's going on.
True.
So, I don't know. I was gonna get to some music.
Yeah,
And Lenny, keep it going for a little bit while I get my stuff together.
Sure, sure. I mean, you know, that's what I was trying to do, is give you a little buffer here.
I know, brother. Thank you.
Keep this conversation.
We're kind of doing this.
This is all freestyle. Also, should I do a rap right now?
We're doing it.
Yeah. I did the beatboxing.
Uh-huh.
I
can't do it.
Beatbox. Just, fun. I can try, but
we're kind of doing this off the cuff and freestyle here.
I'm not rhyming,
so you know. Sorry for the lack of total professionalism, but that's okay. All right, Lenny, take it away.
All right, and so right now we're gonna bring up a couple tracks from the famous, infamous T1000.
Okay, which is which? This is, yeah. This
wait,
is
I, we'll press play and see which one's blowing up.
I think it's the middle one.
There we go.
Ghetto tagging, booty shaking, ghetto tagging, booty shaking, ghetto tagging, booty shaking, ghetto tagging, booty shaking.
Alan Oldham, aka T1000. Woo! Big ups, big ups, big ups to my man. Man, how long have you been in the game? That's like a, what are we talking about? 30 plus years here now? 1987?
Dude!
91? What? When did I got you drop your first record?
When I got into this car, I still had cranks.
Scooby Dooby Doo.
Speed Buggy. Remember Speed Buggy?
Or Fled Flintstone.
No, I've been in the game. Damn. Well, I've been playing like this since 90. Okay. Since 1990. And before that, I had a radio show in Detroit called Fast Forward. And that began in 1987. And I was in college. Oh, wow. And I was able to get this internship at this radio station in Detroit. And I worked there for the summer. They gave me an internship. I started in May. And then I worked there all the way through like August. And then they offered me a show. Nice, and nice. it was overnight.
I'm just making sure that everything.
No, everything's good.
Yeah,
got me scared. So, they gave me an overnight slot, graveyard shift, 3 to 6 a.m. And this is in 1987, and so Derek, I was friends with Derek, and I had done.
Did you guys go to high school together? Oh, or went okay, to school so together too?
Yeah, okay, now we can talk about the
now
old
we're
school.
Going, oh, there we go. We can talk we're
about
going his, there. We're
we can talk
going
about history
there.
Now.
I'm just going to set this up.
Yeah, cool. No, I met Derek May in the 70s. Like, we were kiddie kids.
Wow.
Yeah, like, he lived around the block from my mom to my dad. And, you know how, like, when you're a little kid, right, and then you encounter the little kids from the next block?
Yeah.
And it's like this weird thing because it's like these kids in the next block and then it's your block. And that's how it was with Derek. And he ended up, my mother ended up adopting him.
He came
over to the house and my mom would feed him and all that stuff. And we just kind of remained friends all the time. But anyway, I knew Derek when he was starting his label.
Okay.
And
wow.
And he asked me to
do. You guys were youngin' back then.
Yeah. He asked me to do artwork for Transmat for Nude Photo.
Oh, that's right. You did the first few.
I did.
You?
I did. And that's kind of how I got involved with techno initially. And then when I started my radio show, I went by his house the day of my first broadcast, and he gave me a bunch of white labels.
Now, this is all pre-radio days, too.
No, this is radio. No, we're in radio now. Oh, you mean pre-radio that it was actually invented. No, we were sending smoke signals and, you know, Morse code. But yeah, so I started playing the old Detroit techno stuff on my show in 86, 87. And that's kind of how I got involved in music. Because I started seeing, because I was a comic book artist before that.
Which is, you still
I doing, still, well,
you're still doing
I
this,
still so. Do comics for me, though.
Right, okay.
But back then, my ambition was to Marvel DC, you know, be like a mainstream comic book artist. Mm. That's what I wanted to be since I was a kid. And so it was through that I was doing the artwork for Derek. And then I got mentioned, there was an article called Seven City Techno, which was the very first article that introduced the UK to Detroit techno.
Oh, wow.
And I was mentioned in there, my art and my comics and everything. And I was super excited because, you know, back in the 80s in Detroit, you're this black kid. And it's a British magazine.
Oh, wow. Yeah,
and these are the, imagine. And we used to dream about these, we'd get these magazines, used to dream about them. Used to be like, oh man, I wish I could live in London. Oh my God, I wish I could do. And here I was in there, and that kind of got me started on the path, okay. In terms of making my own music. Mm-hmm. And then the comics kind of went down the drain because I started learning to DJ, and
can't do everything.
Can't do everything. So that's how I got involved with techno. I got in through Derek, you know, really. And then later on, I got hired by Underground Resistance when Jeff left Underground Resistance. And I just happened to be the next guy to call that day. And Mike Banks hired me.
Next.
And that's when I took on the T1000 pseudonym. Because everybody in UR had a DJ name or a code name. Okay. A tactical code name. Okay. And I took that on. So that's how I got started. So this is, I figure, 87.
Wow.
And then I started DJing, like, for real, like this. Like DJing out in 1990, like around Detroit, And then I got into Underground Resistance in 92. And I was their DJ for like two tours. I was with Mike for a year. And then by that time, we started Generator. And I, you know, started trying to make my own tracks. And then...
Trying? What are you talking about?
Well, then, you know.
It did.
Try.
Did.
And I've been going ever since, man.
Nonstop.
30 years.
You know what I think we should do? Because I want to hear her story, how she got in. So we'll do the rotation.
Yeah, let's do that.
We'll do some tracks next, and then we're going to go into that.
Okay.
Our break.
Okay.
And then we'll go.
Yeah, then we'll go into Waynette. All right.
Boom.
Here he is.
Dude, we're going to go right back in.
So, wow. I wasn't even born that time.
Yes.
Woo! Big Robert Owens in that one.
I know, right? All right. All right, we're back to the discussion.
Yep.
My name is Alan Oldham, aka T1000.
Lenny
Posso. This is Lenny Posso, and this is Waynette.
Waynette.
Yeah. There you go. And yeah, we're just talking about stuff and playing records, and
we're gonna go back to the question of our history or how we got into it. I asked you your mm-hmm. history, how you got into the game, this racket, whatever you want to call it. So now we're gonna
now
go
it's Waynette's
to
turn.
Waynette. Yeah.
How I got in. I started listening
did
to...
Did techno choose you, or did you choose techno?
I choose techno. Okay. Yeah, I had the influence of reggae music because of my parents. But in the third grade, I decided to listen to techno and electronic music. How
now,
I got to
let me ask you. So when you were listening, or when you were young, was it playing on the radio? Was it hard to find? Was it like playing everywhere?
No,
because that's
it wasn't
a different thing. That's also a topic too.
I found it by accident. It was on the radio, and we had this radio station, Sunshine Live. It was in Mannheim. So
Germany. Okay,
Mannheim, yeah. And so I was searching for radio stations, and I got to this. And so I started listening to techno by accident. And yeah, but I also saw this Love Parade on TV, and I always wanted to go there since primary school.
I was very interested
in this scene. And yeah. So later I went on with drum and bass, and then directly hardcore. So when I was 18, I joined a few hardcore events, and my.
Now, about what year was that? What years were you joined this drum and bass hardcore?
What year?
Yeah. Because that's significant, I think, of like when.
I was like drum and bass. 17, and not long ago, like long after, it was hardcore, like maybe 1 year.
So at like 97, 98, 99.
It was, let 2000. Me count, 2014, 15.
Oh, okay. Wow. Oh, no. All right. So that's actually
No, even earlier. No, sorry. I was bad in the calculating. 2006. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah,
okay.
I'm much older. 2006, and so I got into this much rougher music, mm-hmm. and I wanted to be a DJ when I was 15, but I hadn't the possibilities. So this all started like a few years later, and I played trance and hardcore vinyl at home. Wow. And
where are you from originally?
From Heidelberg. It's in the south of Germany.
Okay, I know some people from Heidelberg.
So yeah, then I got to Berlin, and I was a bit overwhelmed of all these DJs.
Yeah.
So I stopped at first, and then I got back to playing music.
Cool.
Yeah.
And here you are now.
Yeah.
How long have you been in Berlin?
Since 2011.
And you moved away from Berlin for a little while.
Yeah, I was in Heidelberg for 1.5 years.
Mm-hmm. But you can never stay away from Berlin.
No, not really.
Same with us.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm not going back.
We're gonna mess around and be illegal immigrants here in Germany. If Trump messes around and alienates the Germans, forget
about
it.
We're gonna keep this non-political.
Well, bro, I mean it's relevant because we live here. So
true.
And can't really go home right now either.
I choose not to.
Exactly. We can, but it's not advisable.
Refugees, man.
I know, right? Well, refugees welcome. That'd be us.
Mm. Yeah.
Techno DJ refugees.
So cool. Yeah. That's an interesting segment entrance into this underground world.
What clubs do you play mostly here in Berlin, like before COVID?
At the end, it was Weiße Hase. Mm-hmm. It was former RAW, and I played a few times in Suicide, and it was like always like changing every few months.
Right.
I played like also played in Greenhouse, or I had one chalet gig, and like I'm wondering,
going right. Chalet had the door open to a lot of us. We
totally
all
did.
Or also these small clubs, more underground. But I think the problem. Also the problem was what we talked about before. Like people think I play house, so or tech house, like or like.
Ooh, that's a bad word.
Slower
right?
music.
Tech house.
Yeah. So it was a bit difficult when I got booked because they some people have an imagination and. I play much rougher, so I had
to
fight my way through.
I play much rougher.
Yes.
I don't play none of that light shit, none of that tech house. Is that like
more.
A bad word nowadays? Almost seems like it's a bad word. So listen, we're going to go back into a couple tracks here because we're coming close.
Not yet.
Yeah, well, you better hurry up, man.
Only a few more minutes.
I thought you was all linked up. Okay.
Well, I was.
Yeah, so we got Alan coming up for a couple more tracks. And then I'll just quickly go into my history. Should I just go in now? No. We're going to go in. We're going to say yours. We're going to play along. Other clubs in Berlin, some of the other clubs in Berlin that you were playing at. What is one of your favorites?
It was Suicide. I'm always thinking about the way, the other way, like how playing is, how the sound is, and
yes.
The DJ booth. So it was Suicide. I also like Weiße Hase.
Never been there. Actually.
It's also, I would say more underground and more Berliners are in there.
Okay.
These were my favorite. Spots.
We consider also say like Golden Gate, like a.
I've
Berlin
never played there. No.
Yeah.
I think the sound is too hard. Also, so it's difficult.
Yeah. No, these are fun clubs. I haven't heard of that one, but Suicide Tuesdays was a very nice. Oh, and big ups to Michael and his lovely wife.
They are
great.
Lily.
Yes,
they're really nice.
I
love them.
Great crew. Representing Tuesday, best party of the week.
Probably the
really
best night in Berlin.
Outside of the typical normal.
It's
unbelievable. Yeah.
It's packed for a Tuesday.
Yeah,
and I also played in Blank two times.
All right, so we're going back into Alan Norman. We're going to bring it back.
One last little bit for me.
He's horrible. You can't keep that thing here.
There's nothing to be afraid of. He's absolutely harmless. Except when he hears music, then he goes insane.
Unreleased track for me. This is how Show Going Crazy. That's the name of this track.
Go crazy.
All right. Alan playing an unreleased track there. One of his joints coming out on what label?
Not coming out.
Oh, it's not coming out. It's look at that. Exclusive. Look at that. Exclusive. You guys are lucky. You guys are lucky. Yeah. Getting all the exclusive stuff over here straight out of Berlin. Got the special weapons.
Yep. That was made just for me to play out.
Nice.
That was my attempt at making house music. and that first one was This House Show Going Crazy. That's the name of the track. You know, so anybody in the comments section, if you know where that sample came from, shout it out in the comments section.
And you get a free bonus track.
You know, you'll get the satisfaction of knowing that you can identify the sample. That's what you're going to get. So, Lenny Posso, we were going around the room talking about our history, how we got into this music, and you're the last up.
Oh,
how did you get involved in this, in this racket?
This is going to actually reveal my age then, or my age group.
Dude, you know what? If you went on my wiki, it tells how old I am. I can't even lie about it no more.
Yeah, no, I don't. I'm proud of where, so you know, because I think this is really like a fine wine that kind of like defines us as far as what we've seen, what we've been through.
Yeah, we've earned
we're
it.
We're still in it.
We've earned it, and we're still in it. So, yeah, okay, yeah, go ahead.
No, yeah, all right. So I'm going to start off from the beginning, I guess, like in this, sort of like how you did it. I started off as a dancer. My best friend grew up with, Damien, grew up across the street from my house, and his cousin was a big-time freestyle DJ back then.
Wow,
freestyle back in the day. So I'm going back like 86.
Right.
84, 86.
Right around my time also, mm-hmm. 80s.
And he was DJing in a really famous club in the Bronx, so we had the go. We had the entrance. So me and my best friend Dames, we went in first, going there as a dancer. We were first dancers because we started, I guess, like the whole b-boy breakdancing thing. And then when we found pre-house, like electro, freestyle, all that, we just took naturally to it. So we loved it, you know. And my older cousins also had a big role in that as far as being dancers and, you know, the electro, the roller skating.
Yeah.
I came back from a real big roller skating background. And I was huge back then. Everybody was roller skating. I remember going to Central Park, and everybody was on roller skates. Actually, famous in Central Park, there's a skate circle that's been going on for decades. And I remember Giuliani tried to get rid of it, and the city brought it back because it was just on forever. It was famous that you would go to this one part of the city. I don't remember the name. Forgive me. But it was been going on for decades, and Giuliani tried to get rid of it, and then they brought it back. Yeah. So yeah, going to fast forwarding. So we became big regulars at that club, and then as it progressed, we were going downtown to Manhattan, and then we went to I'd say Sound Factory. 1989 was really like the first time. Then a few as that blew on, we took a liking to the club scene or the whole dancing. And that's what it was really about, the dancing. At some point that I brought up, only a few of us could remember, again, showing my age. This was also a time where we weren't looking at the DJ.
Right.
Everybody was looking on the dance floor.
Right. Yeah.
This is the time where you were on the dance floor and everybody was just looking at the floor. That was the phenomenon. That was what was going on. Drag queens, what they were wearing, how the fashion that was going on. Of course, we came for the music, and you could tell who was really there for the music. And they had other clubs that were for the other reasons that people went. You know, and at the time, too, it was Red Zone was a big club for me. And that was a big...
I remember going there once. I went to Red Zone, and I went to Area.
Oh, wow. Yeah, we're going way back.
This is back during the winter New Music Seminar.
New Music Seminar,
and
yeah,
I went in 89.
Oh,
and,
wow.
And we went to those clubs back then,
mm-hmm,
yeah.
Mm-hmm. A lot of you guys, all you Underground Resistance guys went to that. A lot of people went. I've only heard about it. I was a bit too young, or I didn't really understand all that in the back of the nightlife. I was still just going because of the music, the mm-hmm. culture, or the dancing. And it wasn't until, say, like 94 that I took to the decks, because my best friend and I, as we were dancing, it became bigger in the dancing and all that. Like, the only way that you could have that music was buying the record. If you wanted that record or that track so we could practice our steps, we had to buy the record. So we went downtown. We took records from his cousin or gave him. So he gave them to us. And then sooner or later, I started DJing. My best friend Damien, he had a record store upstate in Albany, New York. I went there a lot. That was a big underground scene there. Legal raves in warehouses and in forests, and we'd camp. You know.
Did you cross over at all into this whole Frankie Bones?
Oh hell yeah, he was
Sonic Groove era Storm Rave.
Yes, actually, I would definitely plug that in because as I was buying records, I went to Sonic Groove Records, and that's where I met so many of the artists. When people ask me nowadays too, like, how do you know these old people that I'm releasing on my label, from DJ Slip, a lot of names, you know, I met them in Sonic Groove record shopping.
Now, is this the Sonic Groove, the one that was in the city?
Carmine Street was the one that I went to the most, and then Satellite, Throb.
See, not to cut you off, but I got to pull rank. Because the first time I went to New York, I went to the original Sonic Groove.
In Bensonhurst.
Yes.
No.
Yeah. Okay. So I had to pull rank on you on that one.
But anyway,
please go ahead.
No. Sonic Groove was a very big institution for many of the techno heads. I mean, that's where I met Function, Damon Wild, Dietrich Schoenemann, who later became our distribution for all the labels coming out of the U.S. for the last 25, 30 years. All those LA cats, they're all being distributed by Function. Dietrich Schoenemann, Complete USA. Props to Dietrich.
Prototype 909 forever.
Oh, yeah. He was one third of Prototype 909 back in the early days. And then eventually I started doing events and parties. And in 2006, I started Thema Recordings. And 2012, I started Chronicle. And now at 2020, I'm over 115 releases with the three labels.
Wow, congratulations.
Thank you, man.
Congratulations. I've been pushing you to make your own tracks, though, for the longest.
And I plan to. It's just that, you know, this transition, one of the things that brought me to Berlin was to be able to get into that seat. But as we all know, and I have to bring this up too, first expats here, it's hard. It's hard. We have to make a living and a lot of things, theorists in different directions.
It's
life experiences.
It's not as cool.
Mistakes.
It's not as cool as it looks on social media.
No, it's difficult
to be living,
you know,
here. You gotta hustle.
We have to make mistakes too. I think I have my fail with relationships, money situations, working. It's been a transition, but learning German, visa. I have next week is my visa appointment, so I had to do all my visa pay or tax papers, all this. It's a lot of work.
Good luck, bro.
Thank you, man.
Good luck, bro.
But I think we're coming down to the time too, right?
We got a couple more minutes.
Okay, all right. Yeah,
we got a couple more minutes. It's crazy.
It is crazy.
And this year's even crazier.
Oh,
with
man,
this
can we just delete this year? Let's just delete this year.
But you know what, though? A lot, it's COVID is, it's tough for a lot of people,
yes,
especially back in the States.
And big shout out, hearts out to all that have been lost.
I know.
Yep. We all know somebody one way or another, some degree of separation.
Who's got lost.
Lost family, cousins, yep, brothers, whatever it is. Hearts go out to all of you.
It's crazy, but, you know, it's good to have a pause button and a reset. I mean, the good thing, I look at the positive, I've got time to draw again. Mm-hmm. And I've been doing a lot of art of late. I have an art show this Thursday at Dream Baby Dream on Greifswalderstrasse. And, having a nice vernissage. And we invite everyone to come on through.
We'll be there.
And, these are my good friends at the bar Dream Baby Dream. Mm-hmm. And they emphasize on, like, industrial and alternative music.
Okay.
And super cool people.
Nice.
And I'll be there.
Be going.
And I have a few of those masks left. I'll be selling those and original art. And I think I have some slip mats and some odds and ends and my paintings and stuff. So everybody is invited. If you're in Berlin, of course, Greifswalderstrasse, Dream Baby Dream, this Thursday, 13 August. Okay, that's my
nice
plug. That's my plug.
All right, Alan, thank you for the invite to be here.
I think that's it. Is that it?
I'm looking in the control room.
Okay, yeah, we're wrapping it up. Thanks for spending 2 hours with us, guys.
Yeah, thank you.
You know, it's
hope
just
we didn't bore you too bad.
just talking about some stuff. I'm trying to not say bad words because
Well, check out also our SoundCloud or Facebook pages. Please, yep. Lenny Posso. Lenny Posso's SoundCloud.
Waynette.
And DJT1000 SoundCloud. So check us out. And yeah, again, if you're in Berlin, Dream Baby Dream, Thursday, August 13th, 6 p.m., my art show. So that's the next thing. So, woo! And I got a
signing out from Berlin.
And I got a couple of podcasts coming up, but you'll hear those when it's out. Okay, signing out from Berlin. This guy jumping the gun. Signing out from Berlin. This is Alan Oldham, Lenny Posso, Waynette. Thank you for having us, and thanks to HÖR for having us. And we'll see you next time. All right, ciao.